Is everyone doing okay out there?
What's up, VC? Back out of the woodwork to do a response to VK Lounge, aka Zipperl, aka Vance, Tree Hunred subscriber contest. That's how we say it in Chicago, Tree Hunred subscriber contest. So congrats, buddy. It's well deserved. Great guy. I mean, we all know and love Zipperl, VK Lounge, aka Vance, brother from Chicago. So again, great guy, genuine, down to earth, shows great stuff. And who would not want to hang out in the VK Lounge? So I'm going to get right on into it. And it's outside today, summer day, although I got some rain clouds moving in, so I got to kind of get right into things here. So what's the premise of this? Show what you got. Show what else you got. Don't show vinyl, although I'm going to break the rules a little bit and show a couple pieces of vinyl because they are not just your typical vinyl. So I'm just going to get on into it. So people have been showing their ticket stubs. So I'm going to show a couple ticket stubs. Not going to bore you with a bunch because we all have a bunch. This is the one from Springsteen's show in Saratoga Springs, New York, a few years back. When was this? In 2009. And so we had pit tickets, and we were standing right off the stage, a few feet off the stage. And who do we see? We see the coach, Pat Riley. Who is, I think, what, owner or part owner of the Miami Heat now. So he's doing really well for himself. He's from Schenectady, New York, just literally, 10 minutes from where I'm at right now. And so he was really cool, just down-to-earth guy, and had him sign my ticket. So that's what a Pat Riley signature signed on my back looks like. And here's another ticket stub. Now, this is the only other ticket stub I will show, and it's a very special ticket stub because, unbeknownst to me until you mentioned this, you and I were both at this show. And this is a show back in 1985, UIC Pavilion, Thursday, March 21st, 1985, 7:30 p.m. And that is U2, baby. And that is the Unforgettable Fire Tour right there. And you and I, from what you said, we were both at that show. So I'll put a little picture of that in here too. So we'll get right to that. Okay, since I did just show a Springsteen item, I'm going to go ahead and show a couple things that are signed Springsteen items. I showed them before in another video, but some of y'all might not have seen them. If you did see them, well, you're going to see them again. If you haven't seen them, well, here you go. So I got the fortunate enough to see him backstage in Chicago back in 99. We had backstage and met him, and we met the whole band. He signed my shirt. Where's my finger? Right in here. And then the backstage pass. So it's cool. He's a really cool guy. What else do I got here? And of course, this is my Springsteen Holy Grail. Now, this is vinyl. I know I'm not supposed to show vinyl, but it's signed. And this is my signed Born in the USA by the entire band. And so that's that. One of my pride and joys of my collezione. One of the grails of the grails. And so I think that's it on the Springsteen stuff. What else I got? I do collect some, here's another couple Springsteen items. Where the heck is that? Wait a minute. Here we go. Okay, these I showed as well. These are collectible and getting expensive, y'all. This is a circulated but full magazine of the making of a rock star, Springsteen Newsweek, back from October 27th, 1975. Now, Springsteen was the first artist or first, I think, person ever to be on the cover of Time and Newsweek in the same week. And there's the Time. Rock's new sensation. And this is October 27th, 1975. Both the same dates, all right? And these are full magazines. And I also acquired a second version, second copy of The Times. So I got two Times and a Newsweek. So those are collectible. So get yourself some vintage Time and Newsweek magazines. I'll extend the magazine tip here for a while. This is one of the rarest Smashing Pumpkins items you'll be able to get right here. This is Reflex Magazine featuring the Smashing Pumpkins. And let me open this up here. And I showed this before as well, but you're about to see it again. And this is featuring an intact, first of all, there's the article about the Smashing Pumpkins, and an intact flexi disc. This right here is going to put you back a few bucks right there, y'all. But so if you see one of these and somebody's selling it for a buck or two, snatch it up because they don't know what they got. All right, so that's that. So that's one of my pride and joy Pumpkins pieces. I also have a few of these debut magazine album magazines. They're magazines, but they also feature a record on the inside. And which one's the one I wanted to show? This one opens up to reveal that advertisement featuring this Walkman, and it's supposed to be size relation to a cassette. As far as, you know, that was all the rage to get smaller and smaller cassette player Walkmans. And so I'll show you, and then it comes with the record, of course. And I just so happen to have that Walkman right here. And this is mine from back when I was a kid, high school era. And it opens, it slides out to make it a little bit larger. And you open it up, and there's your cassette player. And so that's my vintage Sony Walkman cassette player right there, y'all. So I still have that, the original from high school. All right, another couple magazines. Gearhead Magazine is cool to collect. I got about, I don't know, 9 of these or so. Gearhead Magazine, Car Culture Music Magazine. And what these do is they also come with 7-inch records. And let's see, really cool, like there's the Melvins one right there. And we got Fastback, 7-inch comes in, they're split, Rocket from the Crypt and a Helicopter split. So I got Spearhead magazines. So really cool collectibles right there as well. Fun, you know, and of course, also because they come with a 7-inch record. So those are cool. And really great graphics and just great articles, great pictures and boobs and stuff like that. So you can't go wrong with that. So that's the magazine tip. I also collect a bunch of Coca-Cola stuff. And let's see, Coca-Cola signs and anything you can think Coca-Cola. And I also collect calendars because they're Coca-Cola. This is actually the 1968 Coca-Cola calendar. And what's cool is it features a beautiful girl there holding some 7-inch records, getting ready to rock. And you can see how those, they're cutting the rug, right? They're boogieing right there, 60s style. And Vance, I think you and I are both born in the same year. And just to show you, not related to music in any way, but this is the Coca-Cola calendar from 1967. So I believe you and I are born in the same year. So I'm a 67er as well. So that's my Coke stuff. What else? I showed a few of these as well, and these are really cool and getting highly collectible. So jump on this wagon if you want to get in now, because prices are going up. For those of you growing up back in the 80s when vinyl was being phased out and a certain something called CD. What's a CD? What is that? What's it supposed to sound superior? It doesn't scratch. It doesn't skip. It plays by a laser beam. What? A laser beam? Are you kidding me? Well, to transition from the vinyl to the CD, the packaging had to fit in the same rack as a vinyl rack. So what they did is they fashioned a box that would contain a CD, and if you put two side by side, it takes up just as much space as a 12-inch record. So they were still able to use the bins in the music shops to sell CDs, and they came in these cardboard boxes, okay? So basically the CD fit down in the bottom and the rest was just cardboard just for, you know, artwork. So they kind of tried to preserve the artwork phasing in the CD. However, basically what you did is you got a CD and the first thing you did is you just ripped it open and you just tossed this in your back seat of the car and you slid in the CD and you're rocking and you got this pile of ripped up CD boxes in your back seat of the car. So you just threw them away. Nobody thought to go ahead and keep these as a collectible, right? Because they were so ubiquitous at the time. However, the environmentalists and stuff, they got all up in arms about the waste, which is true. I mean, it's a waste, basically, of cardboard and paper and all that in trees. So to conserve on that, they actually, you know, now have just that plastic thing that they insert just the CD and they lock it, and that's the same deal. So show you a few of those. Here's my Dada, one of my all-time favorite bands, Dada. This is the one that has the I'm Going to Disneyland song. And this is Dada Puzzle. And then I have another one of my favorite bands, Sundays. And Queensryche, Empire. And what else we got here? This is a hot one to get. This is the Stone Temple Pilots. This is Widespread Panic. I'm sorry. Widespread Panic, Every Day. And this is Tracy Chapman. I got Stone Temple Pilots in here. This is the Black Crowes. Okay. And what else I got? This is the Genesis Live. This one's pretty easy to get. This is cool. This is the Van Halen Right Here, Right Now CD box. Really good one to have. It's probably tough to get. It's the single soundtrack CD box. Got that one. What else we got? This is a Seal. Still has the CD in it. Unopened. Okay. Soup Dragons. How's that from a blast from the past? I think late 80s, early 90s. Lynch Mob, again, sealed. Still has the CD in here, okay? Has yet to be opened. Not gonna open it. This is Lynch Mob. Okay, let's set these down. I showed you another one of my favorite band, Buffalo Tom, Let Me Come Over. This album is awesome. Get the vinyl. It's easy to get. It's reissued. NXS, X, another one that's sealed, yet to be opened. CD is still inside. And The Pursuit of Happiness. Anybody know of that band? Pursuit of Happiness? Really good. Here's my Stone Temple Pilots right there, the core. This has been opened, but it's still, the box is great. Spin Doctors, Screaming Trees, Peter Gabriel So, Springsteen's Lucky Town, Sunday's Blind. This is a nice one to have. Television, Marquee Moon. Another one of my favorite artists, Matthew Sweet, right there. So that's my stack of CD boxes. Probably my most rare one is a sealed Peter Gabriel Plays Live. That is still sealed, y'all, and that is worth a pretty penny. All right, so that one is highly collectible. My most collectible one right there. So that's that. Okay, let's see here. Let's take a little breather. I'll be right back. All right, moving right along. I used to be insanely obsessed about collecting Victrolas and 78 RPM records about, I don't know, 7-8 years ago. And I pretty much kind of, you know, stopped doing that, but I do have quite the collection. And so here's a few of my records, probably one of the rarer ones. Jelly Roll Morton, and this one's on the His Master's Voice. That's a rare issue right there. Here's another Jelly Roll on the Bluebird label. Look at how cool that label is, Art Deco style, probably from the mid-late 20s. Here is a Duke Ellington on His Master's Voice, Duke Ellington. These, again, are more of my rarer ones. This one is double-sided. We have Jelly Roll Morton, the Shreveport Stomp on one side. It's the Bluebird, and then we got Duke Ellington on the other side. So that's a hot record right there. This one is Fats Waller, piano player. And this one is one of my faves. This one is a Parlophone label. Just pretty label right there. And this is the Louis Armstrong Basin Street Blues. So those are some of my rarer 78s. I'll spin a record for you on my Victor 3 here. So I'll insert that right now. Thank you. Okay, a couple miscellaneous stuff here. This is a Van Halen mouse pad. Do we still use mouse pads? Van Halen mouse pad. Let me know, Vance, if you've ever seen the Bad Examples back in the day. Awesome band, Bad Examples. Chicago band, just party rock and roll. Here's my signed John Panazzo from Styx drumstick right there. And I was fortunate enough to, a buddy of mine who lives in Chicago, actually is really into the music scene in Chicago, and he was the percussionist for Styx on the Edge of the Century tour back in the day. I saw him at the World Theater, and prior to that, he invited me and a buddy of mine to go see rehearsals at a in Indiana, Northwest Indiana. They rented out a gymnasium, and they set up their gear, and they invited us, and we were pretty much amongst about five other people just on folding chairs to sit in them, watch, do their thing and rehearse. It was just the coolest thing ever. So I met all of Styx back in the day. What else? This is a, I should have showed this before with the 78 records. This is a cylinder. This is the initial version of music. This is how it was made right there. Edison cylinder for the cylinder players, which I do not own one. What else I got here? I got loop stuff. Now, those of you obviously don't know a whole lot about what the loop is. Loop is a radio station in Chicago, WLUP, and the loop is a nickname for a certain section of Chicago, and it also is could be the loop with the L tracks or the train tracks. So loop stuff. I have Johnny B, Jonathan Brandmeier. This is a Boner U sweatshirt. If you remember Jonathan Brandmeier, I don't know if he's still around. This is also a baseball jersey of the loop, featuring the loop. And then we have the WLUP. I think that's the, what is that? It's the FM. And then there's the AM 1000 on the sleeve. Here's the loop. What does this say? License holder. What else I got? I got loop. I know you got one of these. Loop FM 98 bumper stickers. What's cool is on the back you get 50 cents off a Maxell cassette. Valid through December 31st, 1981. Okay, that was my first year of high school, 81. Okay, this is also Steve Dahl. I'm a big fan of Steve Dahl. Here's some 7-inch Steve Dahl Teenage Radiation. This is Do You Think I'm Disco and Coho Lip Blues. Here's another 7-inch just featuring the Loop series. Some bands there. What do we got? We got Molly Hatchet and REO Speedwagon. Steve Dahl and Pet Fish Sticks. Steve Dahl, that's a radio DJ. He's now, I think, on a podcast. And this takes you back, brother. Animal Stories. Hello! Uncle Lair and Little Tommy. And so that's the Animal Stories, was a segment of a disc jockey, Larry Lujak. And he did this segment back in the day. All right, last a couple things. Are some Blues Brothers items. Actually, a Blues Brother item. My uncle, who lives on the south side of Chicago, still lives there, in a town called Harvey, and it's not the greatest of neighborhoods now, but he's still holding his own there. And there's the movie The Blues Brothers was filmed in that mall. Remember the mall scene, them crashing all through the stores? It was filmed in a mall, Dixie Square Mall, and it's south side of Chicago. And they basically, the mall was shut down, but the shell of the mall was still there. So they rehabbed the whole inside as a movie set and put, you know, the storefronts and stuff so they could crash through. But when they were running through with the cars, a typical tile floor in a mall, the tires were just spinning. They weren't getting any grip on a mall tile floor. So what the... who was the director? Was it not Spielberg? It was, I forget offhand, but anyway, the director at the time installed these rubberized tiles and just laid it all down on the floor. And I'll insert a picture, but this is a picture of the mall scene, okay? And I'll probably put a still picture of this so you can check that out. And so what my uncle, he's really big into the history of the south side of Chicago and his neighborhood, and he took a journalist through the Dixie Square Mall is all dilapidated, but they still had a bunch of these tiles just laying on the floor. So he picked up quite a few and he gave me one. So this is a tile from the Blues Brothers movie Mall Scene, so they can get grip. And you can see that there's like a mark of something, probably maybe a hood or something skidded on that. So that's pretty cool. A little white skid there, a skid mark. So that is an awesome piece of, remember, that's spit right there, another projectile spit. All right, here we go. Back. One last thing, and we're good to go. These are, I don't really collect a whole lot of these, but this I just acquired at the antique show. I went to Brimfield Antique Show earlier in the week, and this one vendor who sold records, he had these Rush tour programs. Okay, so I got the, was it the Grace Under Pressure, and that's the Signals, and this is the, what is this, Permanent Waves, and of course, the Moving Pictures, and the Piece de Resistance. I'm going to unveil this record on your contest video here. This is the Test for Echo tour program, okay? Now this finishes off my Rare Rush record quest. And yes, sirree Bob, here we go. This here is the Rush Test for Echo. I believe there's only 100 printed record, picture disc only. Issued in 2009, I believe. So this is my unveiling of the Rush Test for Echo. Completes my Rare Rush vinyl collection. So I think I have them all now. Chronicles, I'll get that. And there's that one they do cover songs. That's on the list. Those aren't really, really rare, but you can get those. So that concludes that. I'm going to wind it down. Here's a couple Beavis and Butthead items. Toilet paper. That's, how can you not love Beavis? And this is another record vacuum. Beavis and Butthead aftershave, a couple Beavis and Butthead items. All right, Vance and everybody, hope you enjoyed MibberTube's version of Show Me What You Got. So stay tuned. One more thing, check this out. Stay tuned, don't go anywhere. Here we go, check this out. All right, Vance, I'm going to wind it down with one last thing, and this has absolutely no relation to music whatsoever, but I thought it'd be cool to show you anyway. Since you're from Chicago, I know you'd appreciate this, and others, I think, will too. It's a cool story. So basically what we're going to do is we're going to go back in time to April 3rd, 1991, okay? I was living in Chicago at the time, actually 31st and Morgan. I was going to school in that area right by Comiskey Park, which is 35th and Shields. So basically, Comiskey Park was being demolished to make way for the new stadium. And that's where the White Sox play baseball. And I got my White Sox jersey because this is going to be important here coming up. So this is my number 44 White Sox jersey, okay? So remember that in a little bit. So basically what happened is, you know, everybody knew that the wrecking ball was going to come, you know, and just they had it all fenced off, and the wrecking ball was going to hit Comiskey Park. And to see that is kind of a cool event, just to see the bricks fall and stuff. So so I went there with my camera and, you know, a bunch of people, hundreds of people around the stadium, and started, you know, demolishing the Comiskey Park. So it was so cool that I went home, got my roommate, and said, dude, you got to come back and check this out. This is history in the making. So, but let's just go ahead and watch a little piece of history, and then we'll get to the good stuff. So here we go. Just take a minute to watch this. Come on.
Sox fans holler, say it ain't so, as the wrecking ball silences the crack of the bat and the roar of the crowd forever at the old Comiskey Park. The walls of the oldest park in baseball began crumbling down today. Good evening, I'm Allison Payne.
And I'm Steve Sanders, sitting in for Rick Rosenthal. It was an historic day for Southside Sox fans, and an emotional one.
You're right, Steve. Comiskey is nothing less than a Chicago institution, and saying goodbye wasn't easy for Sox fans. Thousands of people stood by to watch the great white walls crumble down, and to grab a piece of the action. Sid Garcia was there.
Look out, Nelly! Here it comes!
That's a typical Southsider right there.
There were a lot of long faces as generations of White Sox fans came to see their baseball palace come tumbling down. The White Sox have called Comiskey home for more than 80 years. A lot of baseball history has been made here at the corner of 35th and Shields. Sox fans are sad that the final hit here at Comiskey Park comes from a wrecking ball. In 6 to 8 months, old Comiskey will be a parking lot and a memory.
There's memories here that I'll never forget.
A legend.
Met so many nice people. The fans were fantastic.
Okay, so that's Andy the Clown. So basically what I'm going to do is I'll fast forward to a new clip. So check this out. Okay, now here's where it gets good. Now, on the right field side is where the wrecking ball was hitting the bricks and stuff coming down, oohs and ahs. Left field side, on the outside, there was this wall, about 12 foot high brick wall, and hundreds of people, or just milling around the whole stadium, but there was a little special event happening at left field on the outside. Check this out.
With so much attention focused on one corner of the park, some fans saw the wrecking ball as a good diversion. Robert Jordan reports on how nostalgia lost out to souvenir fever.
While the wrecking ball was knocking down the big stuff in the front of Comiskey Park, on the other side, a party, a soup.
Okay, so here's the wall, right? Now, I'm around here, me and my roommate, another guy who's a classmate of ours, us three are just milling about, and you can see all these people are just, it's, you know, they're hopping over the wall, there's kids, adults, and there's no cops, there's no enforcement of any kind from the stadium, you know, demolition crew or anything, so it's just people just having a good old time, the free-for-all, take what you can, and, you know, just a souvenir, do what you gotta do, and so here's us getting caught up in the frenzy of the moment.
Beer search. The festival for frenzied fans was in full swing.
It's a green thing.
Doesn't really matter what it is.
No, it's mine.
Okay, now that is a seat bottom. And just to give you a little teaser, yeah, here's my seat bottom, just like it. Okay? So yeah, I got the same thing. All right? So that's my version. Okay? Along with a brick from that wall. Okay? Here's my brick. Okay? I got quite a few of these, and here's the piece de resistance. Ready?
And it's all mine.
Oh, well, wait a minute. Let's stop here. Wait a minute. You recognize this guy right here? Now, granted, there's a mullet. Now, it was 91. We all had a mullet in 91. So this is me, and that's a classmate of mine, Mark, and then Tom's leading the way, my roommate. And here's the four seats, okay? So what we did is we hopped over the wall, and we went inside the stadium, and we're just awestruck. I mean, there was no sod on the field. It was just all, like, gravelly sand, and all the seats were unbolted off the concrete. And so we're kind of milling around. We just, you know, we're kind of, you know, just taking it in, but we don't know if we're going to get, like, kicked out or busted or whatever. So we looked down at these four seats unbolted, and the cumulative light bulb went off over all of our heads, and we're like, yes, we're going to take these fucking seats, right? So we hoisted them, they're heavy as hell, and hoisted them toward the wall, and we lifted them up, and we teetered them over the wall. You know, one guy hopped over the wall, and we teetered them over and got them down that way, and then the other two of us, we hopped over and just carried them out. Robert Jordan, he wanted to stop and interview us, and we're just like, no, we want to get the hell out of there, because we didn't know if we were going to get busted. I mean, that's a... Nobody walked out with these things. Nobody. We were the only ones that had the balls to walk out with four seats. As far as I know, maybe after they saw us do it, people might have done it. But we were the first to hop over the wall with this amount of goodness right here. So that's me right there with the 44 jersey taking the seats. That's a historic day in my life. Captured. How cool. On WGN News, 1991, April 3rd, a day of my life. And again, there is the 44 jersey. I still have it, and I will always have it. And that's just a little piece of my life right there, captured. And there you go. So hope you enjoyed that, y'all. And we'll see y'all next time. All right? So member two, Vance, congratulations, buddy, 300. We'll see you at 400, 500, 600. And we'll talk to you next time, y'all. VC, I love you. Later.